Hello, and welcome to the first edition of this new musical quiz, in which the team's knowledge of music of all kinds will be tested in a series of questions. We hope you at home will be intrigued and take part yourselves as well. First, meet the two teams. On the one hand, David Franklin and Frank Muir, and challenging them, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. Let's go straight into round one, then, which concerns light classical music, gentlemen. I'm going to ask each contestant in turn to identify a well-known composition and its composer. One mark for the title, one mark for the composer. First of all, David Franklin. What is this tune? Incidentally, what's it from, and who composed it? There you are.
You didn't think I knew, did
you? No, no.
Well, I do. El Amor Brujo.
Marvellous.
By De Falla.
Well, it's from El Amor Brujo. To be precise, it's the...
Yes, I missed out the word from.
I'm trying to get you to say ritual fire dance, you see. From El Amor Brujo.
Yes, fire. But I was saying it in the original Spanish. El Amor Brujo.
All right, so you get your two marks. And on to the next tune, Denis Norden. Here's your tune. Right, Dennis, that's easy too, isn't it?
Yes, because this one is one of those bits of music that's always inseparable from its composer, because people always refer to it as Ravel's Bolero, as though there was a sort of Thackeray's Bolero. Was there the co-opted one?
Yes. Two marks, and on to Ian Wallace. Ian, can you identify this under both its titles, please? Just a little more difficult, perhaps, because it's so much out of the middle, isn't it? Do you know what it is, Ian?
I have a feeling that it's from the overture by Mendelssohn, the Hebrides.
Yes, you're right. So when I said both titles, the other title I was after was...
Fred's Cave. No, I think one title will have to do
with... all right, give one and a half marks, I think we'll give you. The other one was Fingal's Cave, the other title.
Well,
one
as
and
a half Scott, marks. I should have known that. Really.
And, Frank Muir, what is this called?
Under which of its titles?
Colonel Bogey, Mark.
Well done. So I think you get two marks if you're not having the courage to reply.
Yes.
Two marks. In the next round, I'm going to ask you the meaning of some musical terms which are in constant use. If you don't actually know them, you can probably make an intelligent guess. Well, at any rate, a guess. For two marks, then, David Franklin, what does legato mean?
Smooth.
Yes, Lee.
With all the notes linked up together.
I think you might demonstrate vocally for your two marks.
Well, I just said smooth.
Sound like a commercial.
I hope.
Denis Norden, what is prestissimo?
Well, that's the musical way of saying pull your finger out. It means fast, jolly quick.
Two marks, very quickly, yes. Ian Wallace, con brio.
Con brio means with a good deal of energy and...
Brio.
Brio. I think you might give us a little bit of a snatch of song sung con brio, will you?
Well, I think one would say... La 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 la, something like
very
that.
Very good, two marks. And Frank Muir...
Frank Beer meant with cheese.
I thought it was a continental breakfast.
Frank, what do you mean by pizzicato?
Pizzicato is when the violinist laughingly tosses the bow over his left shoulder and tweaks the strings.
For that you get 2 marks. And on to the next round, opera. You'll all recognise the operatic pieces we're going to play for you. And you must probably know them by their Italian titles too. But do you know what the titles mean, literally, in English? For 2 marks, David Franklin, what does this title mean when literally translated? Well, first of all, the title, I think.
Vesti la giubba.
And it means? Your teammate is dumbfounded.
Probably you singing. I didn't really question it.
It means dress, put on your clown's costume. Mm. On yes. with the motley, it's usually translated. Mm,
yes, on with your coat, costume, in this case, motley. Oh, that's fair enough for 2 marks. Do you know which character sings it in the opera?
Yes. It's a character called Tonio.
Yes.
In the opera Pagliacci by Leon Caballo.
You certainly got your feet. Denis, we shall expect equally as much information from you. here's your aria.
Just don't hold your breath.
Well?
That's called La Donna e Mobile.
And it means?
And it means the bird's got a motorbike. No, it means woman is mobile, is what's that word? Fickle.
Yes, 2 marks. At least 2 marks. Ian Wallace, what does the first vocal line in this mean? Now you may speak.
You can't translate that.
But it's not the first line, is it? Well, the title line, then. The title. The Italian title.
Well, it's called the Largo al Factotum, mm-hmm. from the Barber of Seville by Rossini. Mm-hmm.
The line is Largo al Factotum della città, isn't it?
And yes, well, della città is off the city.
Off the city, yes.
Factotum is... factotum.
I'll buy it. We're getting warm enough for my liking now.
I am the general factotum of the city, and the city is Seville, if that's any in Spain.
Yes, who's the most important man in the city? Two marks, and here's the operatic aria for you, Frank Muir. Frank Muir. I'm not back announcing it. I'm calling on Frank.
I don't recognise the gentleman singing it. But it's the Miserere. It's the number.
Yeah. What does it mean?
It means miserable. It's a very downbeat piece, the Miserere.
You're evading the... Well, a mark up to now, I think. Do you know the meaning of Miserere?
Well, it's from my distinguished colleague on my dexter side. says that Trovatore.
That's what he meant.
Rotten writing. Il Trovatore, which means that Trovatore was not well, and was feeling very sad and miserable, hence the Miserere.
Yeah, any time we ask for a synopsis, we'll probably get the translation, won't we? One mark, I think. It's the Miserere meaning have mercy from Il Trovatore, which means, incidentally, the troubadour, by Verdi. Now a round which tests your knowledge of musical forms, whatever they are. The following terms are used for certain types of compositions. For 2 marks, what is, David Franklin, a sonata?
The sonata is a piece of music for one or two solo instruments, and it has a certain form.
Yeah, I know you're
thinking.
It has
a sort of shape.
Yes. How many movements will it have?
Three?
Usually, at least
usually three.
Usually
three,
yes.
Sometimes four.
Marvellous answer, 2 marks. Denis Norden. Denis, what is an oratorio?
Comes from the Latin, Steve. Ora. Oratorio, bull. Gives you aura bull. It's a sung thing, which is for, I believe it's for voices only.
Well, no, I don't.
On a religious theme.
On a religious theme, yes. And it's like a verse reading, only it's sung.
I think that squares with my definition here. Semi-dramatic musical composition, usually on a sacred theme, 2 marks. Ian, what is a concerto?
A concerto is a piece for a solo instrument accompanied by symphony orchestra.
Very good, or perhaps two solo instruments.
Perhaps two solo instruments.
2 marks, anyway. And Frank Muir, what is a fugue?
What indeed?
Yes.
A fugue, what is it? We're not in competition, you may speak freely.
It's a piece of music.
I know, we know that.
Don't be so cross, I'm trying to help. It's a piece of music in which the same tune is taken up in turn by different instruments.
Oh, that's right, yes, the theme. One of these things where the theme is stated by the woodwind, is then tossed over to the horns, is then picked up by the trombones, centred by the percussion.
You've been reading L.C. sleeve notes, haven't you? And of course it's polyphonic, isn't it, too?
No, it's masculine.
I think that's fair enough for 2 months. Whatever it was you said, it's all right for 2 months. In this next round, Graham Dalley is going to play the first 2 lines of some old traditional song, and it will then be up to each member of the team in turn to sing a verse. Attempts will be marked by me according to accuracy, panache, any other quality I can think of. So there's a possible 4 marks in all. David, listen first, then give me the title, and then please sing 4 lines. Can you manage the title?
It's a Welsh folk song. The Ash Grove.
Yes, that's 1 mark anyway.
Da da da, barbed wire.
I didn't know it.
I haven't the notion what the real words are. It's never been in my rep.
Down yonder green valley where streamlets meander, when twilight is fading, I pensively rove. Do you really want any more? That's how the words go.
I didn't really want that long.
We were hoping for twice as much in the key of E major or something. 1 mark out of 4 there. I can't really manage any more. And Denis Norden, here's the tune we want you to identify and then sing, please.
Little brown jug, how I love thee. Or, you know, do I get a mark for neatness?
Yeah. I think on the whole I prefer the B side. It's Little Brown Jug, Don't I Love Thee. I think 3 out of 4 would be generous to a fault. Do they?
Yes, charitable.
Ian Wallace, here's one for you that I personally couldn't sing, so let's hope you can. Here's yours.
It is. It's Tom Bowling, an old sea song.
1 mark, yes.
Don't think I know the words, unfortunately. I can sing the tune for you. If
oh, let's have some problems.
Not in that key.
No, in any
but it's, it goes
to say it, but 3 marks out of 4, lovely, but there was only DD, wasn't
yes,
it? Not even La La, DD.
Well, there was an F sharp there somewhere.
I could have sung the tune of the Ashgrove, but you wanted the word.
All right, then, let's give him another one, shall we? Another one for David down there. I have a young lady called Val sitting next to me who's prepared to cheat us out.
I know. I think if you make these complaints, you get your name taken.
The next round, can we give Denis a mark not to sing?
Hello, Ian Wallace now.
The day's treat, now we come to Frank Muir.
The singing writer.
Sing that bit. Start at the beginning.
Start at the beginning.
Oh. Early one morning, just as the sun was rising, I heard a maid singing in the valley below. Oh, never leave me. Oh, don't deceive me. How could you maiden. So.
Ungrateful, the question master who knocks off any marks for that. Yes. 4 marks. Very good. So far, we haven't had much dance music. We now play for you a round of dances, some old, some new. And for 2 marks, we want you to tell us not the title of the piece, please. That would be just too easy. But the name of the dance. David Franklin, which dance is this? And Roses, but what's the dance?
It is, I found it a difficult to speak that was so beautiful. It's a slow foxtrot.
Well, now, here we're in trouble, you see, because I maintain that one could slow foxtrot to it. So I couldn't really take issue with you on that, but I'm reliably informed that it's a... Well, shall I? What sort of time of day would you like to do it, and how would you walk to it? Does that give you any kind of a hint?
How would I walk to it?
Yes, would you amble or run? Or...
Sir, when I do a slow fox trot, I do a slow fox trot.
I fear we're at cross purposes. I was trying to get you to say moonlight saunter. But I really can't fault this slow fox trot. I'm going to give you 2 marks for the slow fox trot, because even if nobody else could, you and I could do a slow fox trot too, with our respective women.
Of course.
No. Denis, let's see if I got any better with yours. Here's your tune.
Is it the Lancers or the Gavotte? Is it the Lancers?
I must give you no marks.
Well, is it Gavotte or... No, it's some kind of... It's one of these qualifiers. The military two-step?
All right, then. 1 mark. It's the Boston two-step.
Civilian two-step. Yeah.
I thought you were going to say that when you did it, it was the slow foxtrot. Anyway, on to the next one and the dance tune for Ian Wallace. Very easy, Ian.
Twist.
Yes, let's twist again. Two marks. And, Frank, can you identify this dance?
Vengan chicos, vengan chicas, dance by dance.
What's that shouting at me? Just
Johnny and Charlie, if you want to know, on the record label.
It's a fertility dance. From the Mediterranean.
Yes, that much is right, isn't it?
Yeah. It's one of those terribly exhausting dances which has a brief vogue and then disappears. And the faintest there.
I'll give you half a mark for accidentally saying the Mediterranean. It came originally from Majorca, or as I would have it, Mallorca. It's La Yenka. In this round, I'm going to ask questions on the general knowledge, but with a musical background. 3 marks maximum for your answer. David Franklin, you first of all, can you tell us, please, why was Haydn's Surprise Symphony such a surprise?
Haydn worked for Prince Esterházy. Well, he deserved it. And he worked on a big family estate in Hungary, and he was his private composer. He ran the prince's private band. And when the chaps, the prince's family and his guests, went in to listen to the evening's concert after dinner, they'd eaten so much and they drank so much that normally in the slow bit, which was the quiet bit, they all dropped off. And this was Haydn's idea of a joke. I don't think it's very funny. But in the slow bit, he slipped in an enormous chord to wake them all up. This was held to be a surprise.
It's funny.
Well, you know, you told that story with such conviction that I'm bound to give you the full 3 marks, although I was under the impression that Haydn, about to come to England, where he was told that audiences were notoriously sleepy in symphony concerts, wrote some symphonies for England, one of which was the Surprise Symphony, with a loud chord in, for the reason you gave. Denis Norden, why did Gilbert and Sullivan separate after such a successful partnership? What made them separate?
Well, Steve, one of them died. But there was an incident at the Savoy Theatre, which they built out of the lolly that they owned, with Doyle Cart. And it concerned the furnishings of the Savoy Theatre. I'm drawing heavily on my memories of a radio programme by Leslie Bailey. Yeah, and they quarrelled as to whether the money should be spent on the furnishings, and then they split up, and one of them went on writing, the other one joined the BBC as assistant head of light entertainment.
Three marks, you're quite right. It was a £140 carpet, as a matter of fact, for the Savoy Theatre, bought for the comfort of its patrons, and they fell out over it and parted for 4 years. Informed. 3 marks. Ian Wallace, why was Beethoven unable to complete his unfinished symphony?
And I rather think for the same reason as the final parting between Gilbert and Sullivan, because he died before he had finished it.
I heard that it was because he wanted to leave room for the commercial.
I heard that he didn't complete his symphony because Schubert wrote it.
Yes, that's more like it, isn't it? It was Schubert who unfinished it, not Beethoven who unfinished it.
A trick question.
A trick question. Frank, why did Nero fiddle while Rome burned?
The legend, of course, is that Nero, seeing his city in flames, picked up his violin and tore off a couple of quick choruses of the Hot Canary. Now, my knowledge of music is almost nil, but I happen to have a book called A History of Music by Charles Burney. But I read the first volume because it's all full of illustrations of old instruments. And what I read and remembered from this was, in fact, the Romans didn't invent the whole of the Roman times. No new musical instrument was invented. And in fact, the only way to play a stringed instrument was pizzicato.
Or they did tweak the strings with a thing rather like an ivory ballpoint pen. But bows came later. And so, in fact, Nero couldn't have fiddled, because he had nothing to fiddle with, nothing to hold in the right hand. And, in fact, there were no violins. So that's the kind of Beethoven question, I fancy.
I don't see how I can do anything but give you three marks for that.
Hello.
Do you, Ian?
Very good.
I was rather hoping for four.
And we now look down at the sheet to see the final score. David Franklin and Frank Muir have won by 4.5 marks. And that, I'm very sorry to say, brings us to the end of this edition of My Music. We've enjoyed it, and we hope you did too. Goodbye.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Denis Norden, Frank Muir, and Ian Wallace. The chairman was Steve Race. At the mellotron was Graham Dalley. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason. The program, which was recorded, was produced by Tony Schreier. We present My Music, a new musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here to introduce the two teams is your chairman, Steve Race.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of My Music, in which the team's knowledge of music of all kinds is tested in a series of questions, which we hope you at home will answer as well while you listen. First, meet our two teams. On the one hand, David Franklin and Frank Muir, and they're challenging Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. As we're just beginning the programme, it's appropriate, I think, to begin with a round of famous overtures. For 2 marks, can you give, in each case, the title of the overture and then who wrote it? Here's the one for David Franklin. Stormy stuff. David, do you know which opera?
Of course, the difficulty with an opera singer is that when the overture is being played, he's still in his dressing room making up and wondering where his trousers have got to. Is it Rossini?
Yes.
William Tell.
Very good. 2 marks. Denis Norden, here's the music for you to listen to. Dennis, did you hear that properly?
I did, yes. The other overture that I know. That was played on the harmonica with all the optional accessories. 1812.
Yes, by whom?
Tchaikovsky.
Thank you very much. Who played the canon on that recording, do you know?
Larry Adler.
That's quite right, yes. Now you get your 2 marks. Overture coming up for Ian Wallace. Favourite overtures. Do you know what it is?
I think so. I would say that was the overture to The Bastard Bride by Smetana.
You would be correct. 2 marks. Very good. You didn't even know she was married, did you?
I tell you, one thing about Smetana was he did jolly well know which side his bride was bartered.
Check. Now, Frank Muir, your overture. Yes, sir.
In Jimmy Edwards' act, he comes on with a euphonium case, opens it, and removes a miniature cornet from it, and says, I'm now going to play the Overture Light Cavalry by Supé. He only actually blows about 8 bars of it because it gives him a sick headache. And he also says, Overture Light Cavalry, stand by your buckets. It's really Jimmy Edwards' laugh, not mine. Overture Light Cavalry, Supé.
And 2 marks for that, and we move on to the next set of questions around about general musical knowledge. For 2 marks, first of all, David Franklin once again. With what kind of music, David, do you associate Messrs. Moody and Sankey?
Moody and Sankey with American evangelistic hymns.
American ones, yes. Well, evangelistic hymns, certainly. 2 marks. Denis Norden, how are the strings on a violin tuned?
I used to play the violin. I didn't play the violin. I learnt the violin when I was 11 for 3 weeks. There's some trouble with the rosin and the dog. well, they're tuned by... turn these little knobs at the end of the violin.
Like ears.
Yeah. If you will notice at the end of the violin, there are 4 bits sticking out to each side. If you turn those, as I did, eventually the string snaps.
Serves me right for asking the question in that form. I meant, of course, to which notes are the strings of the violin?
Oh, dear. Wait a minute. The nearest one to you...
To me.
G. Is to me. No, to me. I'm holding it, as it were, mentally.
You must be a southpaw.
is G. And the furthest one is E. And there's 2 in the middle of that. And I don't think I reached those 2, actually. I was the only one who could do double stopping across the 2 outside strings. What's the 2?
Can you get them? G, something,
G,
something.
G. Ian.
I think... I'm not a violinist, but I think there is a G, an E, and an A in the midst of it.
Yeah, well, yeah. I have to give you 1.5 marks because there's a D you missed out. G, D, A, E. 1.5 marks then. And I think I really ought to congratulate you, Dennis, on being the first violinist to tune your strings that way round. Uh-huh. Everybody else has the G string on the outside. Ian Wallace, your question. What is absolute pitch?
Absolute pitch is the capacity to sing a note and or produce a note on an instrument and know that that note is E or E flat or whatever, to get the exact number of vibrations that go. This is something that is a wonderful gift for musicians. A lot don't have it, and I am one of those who definitely does not have it.
Now, that's 2 marks. I'm jolly good, Ian, because it's one of those things like a spiral staircase. It's very difficult to describe somehow in words when you're really faced with it.
Yeah.
Absolute pitch, yes, it's a gift, isn't it, which not many people have, and it's a very good thing to have if you happen to be a musician, especially, of course, if you're a singer fighting the orchestra like mad in a very modern work.
Mm. Yeah. It's one of those things where if you hear a scream in the night and somebody says, what's that, you say, B flat.
Frank Muir, your question coming up on this round. Who is the patron saint of music?
I think it's the BBC at the moment. Apart from that, it's Calliope or something.
What?
Calliope? Cecil.
Cecil.
I wish you'd write more clearly.
I'll have to do everything in block capitals, wouldn't you?
Cecilia.
Yes.
You should have written it the right way around, David, otherwise he'd have said Cecil Street.
I'm still numbed by the fact that Dennis played the violin. I never knew.
How are we doing? Val next to me is doing the addition sums. Ian Wallace and Denis Norden have 7.5 marks. David Franklin and Frank Muir lead with 8 marks. Something a little more in the popular line now. For 2 marks, gentlemen, can you identify the following musical groups or bands by the style of music and the kind of sound they make? David Franklin, your turn first. Now, David, we know it was you singing on that, but can you remember the name of the group?
South American.
Yes.
I don't know how to pronounce it. You must bear with me. Los Paraguayos?
Very, very good, yes. Marvellous. Denis Norden, this is a difficult one, so I'll give you a slight hint by telling you it's not a Raggy Waltz, but... And here's the music.
Taking the hint, as is it the man who mucks about with time signatures quite a lot?
Yes, it is. It's,
and that was Joe Morello on drums.
Well, it could have been if the record had been made a bit later.
Oh.
It's the right group, though. Name
Dave Brubeck.
Yes, Dave Brubeck. It was rather an early record, which I thought I ought to. I owed you a clue, and I don't think Joe Morello was with the group then, but that's a minor point. 2 marks. Ian Wallace. Can you name the man, Ian, or if not that, the party?
Brass?
Yes. The leader played a brass instrument originally.
Oh.
Originally?
Yes.
The party.
Yeah, well, I'd say that, didn't I? Yes.
Ted Heath.
Yes! Yes. Edward Heath and his music, yes. Yeah. Here's a group for you, Frank Muir.
Aliens. French.
Yes. And yeah, we get 2 marks for that.
Is it an orchestra?
Pardon?
Am I looking for an orchestra?
No, you're not. You know, just a bunch of friends, that's all. Not necessarily an orchestra.
Companions.
Yeah.
Companions of the song.
Yes. Would you guys translate for us?
Compagnons de la chanson.
De. Deux marks, bon. Whatever marks are in French. Deux marks, yeah. Very good. Here's a round to test your knowledge of musical theory. For 2 marks, David Franklin, what is the adjective that comes from the word counterpoint?
The only one I know that it would be safe to let loose on this programme is contrapuntal.
Yes, and for the other mark, very roughly, what does it mean, please?
It means the apposition. That's a good one, isn't it? The apposition of a counter melody against the melody on the top.
Very, very good, yes. Marvellous. Denis Norden, very simple one for you. What is a fifer? Fifer.
Fifer. Well, you know the musical term, a tenor. A fifer is...
Well, my father was a fifer. He was born in Kirkcaldy.
That's right. A fifer is Ian Wallace's father. It's a musical term for Ian Wallace's father.
A man who plays the fife.
It could be a man who plays the fife.
Yes. Two marks. Ian, what is the meaning of sforzando?
Sforzando is going from playing
bad to foot.
You know, it's a very difficult one to describe, a sforzando.
Just at all.
Well, you attack loud and come to soft.
Well, I've got to give it to you because you attack loud, but you don't have to come to soft to be sforzando. It just means forced.
Yes.
Forcing or forced. Accentuated.
Like, accentuated, yes. I would agree with you, yes.
You would, yes. Would you agree with me as to how it's spelt?
S.
Yes.
S-F-O-R-Z-A-N-D-O.
Yes, thank you. Two marks. Frank Muir, your highly technical question. Pray, what is a paso doble?
Paso doble is a dance. A rather wild dance. Rather nice, rhythmical. South American. Or Spanish.
Yes, better.
Spanish, more than. Slightly more than South American.
Could you dance
it? No, not
no. I was going to say, sing a few bars with Paso doble. Or identify one. Yes, very nice. Two marks. In this round, you're going to hear Graham Dalley on the mellotron playing the first few bars of an old traditional song. For three marks, you have to continue the song with, please, the correct words. So we want the songs continued, sung with the words. David Franklin, here's yours. Contrapuntal. Can you
what
sing that?
What's up there?
I think you choose your absolute pitch for this.
Da 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 da, and left their tails behind them. Is that right?
No, absolutely wrong. It's the girl I left behind me. I've got a lot of stuff on my card here about I'm lonesome since I crossed the hill and all the moor and valley and so on.
You know when David was saying about leaving his trousers, but this is going on to a function he left his tails behind. Obsession with clothing.
Funnily enough, we move on now to something which is appropriate. Denis Norden, here's yours.
The Eton boating song.
Mm-hmm. You have to sing it, remember, with the words. With
something, something, breeze. Oh, there's a terribly obscure line to it. Blade on the feather. Something, something, trees. I'm going up too high. And we'll all pull. All pull together. And there's something between their knees. I don't know, the oar. No, you couldn't do that, could you? The rudder between no. Something between the knees, and it's repeating.
Very
you can
good.
Send for a pamphlet for this, if you're anywhere obscure. What is it between the knees?
Well, it says on my card your bodies. I've heard your bags, and you think it's heads, David, do you?
Yeah, no.
Any Italians?
That's
Frank, you went to Eton, didn't you? I seem to recall.
No, Slough.
A song to be continued next by Ian Wallace.
That I know the name, but I know the tune.
Well, I I'll give you one mark for saying Barbara Allen. In Scarlet Town, where I was born, there was a fair maid dwelling, and so on. Yes, it's all right, one mark for that. Frank, here is yours.
From Macbeth. Where the three witches were incarcerated in the castle. Oh dear, what can the matter be? Johnny is so long at the fair. He promised to buy me a bunch of blue ribbons. He promised to buy me a bunch of blue ribbons. He promised to buy me a bunch of blue ribbons to tie up my bonny brown hair.
Beautiful, yes.
Can matter be? Three old ladies locked.
Three marks. And we move on to the next round. A rather quiet round. Piano music. For two marks, can you identify the, first of all, the item and then the composer, David? Got a bit of it there.
It's a piano. It's a transcription for piano of a chorale by Bach.
Yes.
Popularly known. May safely graze.
Yes, from Cantata 208. Two marks. Denis, here's yours.
Fantastic.
No, I think it's very good the way Edward Mason tempers the musical wind to this Sean Lamb.
You're safely grazing.
Chopin's Minute Waltz, and for higher productivity, we do it in 50 seconds.
Yes, it was two marks from that. It was tempered more than you know. That version was played by Winifred Atwell on the piano. Ian, here's some piano music for you to identify. Who wrote it's almost more interesting than what that
wrote it. Charles Chaplin,
yes,
wrote it. It brings back memories to me of various, sitting in various restaurants where they have that piped music.
Yes.
And this comes through so that you can't hear the conversation of the people at the next table. And it's from Limelight.
Mm.
I don't know who's playing it.
Well, it doesn't matter. It was Russ Conway playing it. You're quite right. Charles Chaplin, Limelight, the background. We call it knife and fork music in the train. That's right. Two marks for that, Limelight, from the film of the same name. And Frank, some piano music for you.
I know what it is.
Well, that's all I asked, actually.
Played by Alfred Smallpiece. I recognized his left hand. It's a short or mini skirt, though.
Do you know who wrote it?
It's a scherzo from... no.
Well, don't cudgel your brains for from. By whom, you don't know. Well, one mark, anyway. It's by Litolf.
I'd be Litolf lightly, then. One mark.
Right, we move on. Again, for two marks. I want to know the Christian names of the following composers. David, Christian names, please, of Mozart.
Wolfgang Amadeus.
Yes, very good. Denis, that's two marks for that. Denis, Rachmaninoff.
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 I thought that was his Christian name included. Like Rach Hudson. Rachmaninoff. Ian, I look pleadingly towards you.
I don't know. I think...
Serge. He was known as Blue Serge.
Yes.
Rachmaninoff.
Two for that.
Thank you, Ian.
Oh, it's
Ian Gounod. Or rather, Ian Wallace. Gounod.
It would be Ian O'Goon.
Gounod. Charles.
Yes. Charles François. I have it. Yes. And Frank Brahms.
Johann Sebastian Bach. Johann Sebastian Bach, but...
Johannes.
Johannes Brahms, yes.
Johnny.
Yes. Quite right. 2 marks. A round of dances old and new. For 2 marks, to tell me not the tune, but the name of the dance. David. Now, not what would you do to that, but what should you do?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, if I'm to answer that question, I should sit it out. But if you want to know what I should be sitting out to, I should be sitting out to a cha-cha-cha, or is it cha-cha-cha-cha? I never know how many chas there are. Well, two chas, three?
You get half a point a char, the way you've done it. I think it's the cha-cha. Victor Sylvester on that record called it the cha-cha-cha, and you get 2 points. Dennis, here's one for you.
Your cup of tea, isn't it?
Somehow
yes,
doing this.
I know. And that is Daisy wearing 40 yards of tulle. Which she designed herself. That's a tango.
Yes.
I never could.
2 marks. Ian, what would you and your friends do to this?
Palais Glide?
Yes. 2 marks.
Oh, good.
And finally, Frank Muir.
Where we came in.
Yes, it is.
I've been passing somebody at the double. It's a paso doble.
It is, that's right. 2 marks. And that's that brings us to the end of this week's My Music. The final score, it's incredible. But Ian Wallace and Denis Norden have been beaten by David Franklin and Frank Muir by half a mark.
Taking part in My Music with David Franklin, Denis Norden, Frank Muir, and Ian Wallace. The chairman was Steve Race. At the Mellotron was Graham Dalley. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason. The program, which was recorded, was produced by Tony Schreier. We present My Music, a new musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here to introduce the two teams is your chairman, Steve Race.
Hello and welcome to another edition of My Music, in which the team's knowledge of music of all kinds is tested in a series of questions. We hope you at home will take part as well. First, our two teams. On the one hand, David Franklin and Frank Muir, and they're challenging Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. First, a round of popular, light and classical music. For 2 marks, what are the following and who composed them? David Franklin, here's yours. I think that's quite a difficult one, but maybe you know it. David?
I think it's impossible.
It isn't. I'll tell you what it is.
let me guess.
Tell me half what it is. I know the area it is. I'm not sure which one it is.
You know, I thought it was I'm Dreaming of a White Warsaw.
No, it isn't. It
isn't. Well, is it Somebody's Dream?
No, it's not Anybody's Dream. It's Somebody's Rhapsody, I'll tell
it's
you.
It's Somebody's Rhapsody.
It's one of these film bits, isn't it?
No, oh, I don't go to the films.
Do you go to the pictures?
No. It's the last time I went to the pictures, it was still called the Bioscope.
It's one of these themes from films.
If I had a bell, I'd ring it, because you really don't know, do you?
No, Cornish Rhapsody.
Yes, all right, one
Cornish
mark,
Rhapsody,
I think.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, one I thought mark. It was The Dream of Olwen.
No, no, it's the Cornish Rhapsody by, for your second mark, whom? No?
Edinson?
No, by Herbert Bath.
No Bath.
Love story. Well, I gave you one because Frank got the title of the piece.
Well, thank you very much.
I think, well, you're a team after all, aren't you? Denis Norden, here's one for you to identify. You don't have to identify so much as just repeat.
Repeat it, yes. All the work's been done. It was Anton Walbrook, and he was very handsome as this Polish flying option. Doctor, will I ever play the piano again? You know. Warsaw Concerto.
Bye.
By Richard Adinsell.
Yes. That's your 2 marks.
Something Moonlight.
Dangerous Moonlight, yes. 2 marks. Ian Wallace, here's one for you. Titan composer, please.
Hungarian Rhapsody number 2 by Liszt.
Yes, there's been some complication about the numbering in the course of time, but certainly that's how it's known, the second Hungarian Rhapsody by Franz Liszt. 2 marks.
The way you looked at me, I thought I was quite wrong.
Oh, no, you're quite right. That's part of the art of being a nasty, crafty challenge. And, Frank, here's one for you.
Persian pheasant. It's one of these glories of brass banditry. The overture of Persian pheasant.
By?
Jimmy Edwards. In his act.
Here we are.
Come on. With the euphonium case, open it and produce a small trombone. And he used to play the overture to the Persian peasant. It's by the chap who wrote all the overtures for Jimmy Edwards to play on his brass instruments, Monsieur Suppé.
Yes, 2 marks. A round of general knowledge questions on music. For 2 marks, David, for what do the following initials stand? There's 1 mark for each set of initials. First of all, FRCM. Would you like to answer that? FRCM.
A Fellow of the Royal College of Music.
Thank you. 1 mark. And BBCM.
BBCM?
Yeah.
British Broadcasting Corporation, Muir.
BBCM?
Yes.
BBCM.
BBCM.
BBC Midlands.
Well, I can't take that because it's not really musical knowledge, is it? Bandmaster of the Bandsman's College of Music, Kneller Hall.
Good Lord.
M, 1 mark, then after 2. Dennis, which famous national anthem has been used in at least 3 different countries?
Well, ours is used in America. Uh-huh.
As
My country 'tis of thee.
Yes.
Sweet land of liberty.
Is it used anywhere else?
Yes.
Ian has written... Were you ever a doctor, Ian? I know, it could be anywhere. The Seychelles, no? Switzerland. Switzerland.
Yeah, for all I know, possibly. It's also played throughout Germany under a title I daren't pronounce, but I'll give you 2 marks just the same. God Save the Queen, My Country, Tis of Thee, and Hail Dear in Stephen Krantz. Ian, rather long question for you. Short answer, perhaps, too. We all know that Bernard Shaw wrote Pygmalion. It became a musical under the title of My Fair Lady. But this happened earlier to another of Shaw's plays. What was the play called? What was the title of the musical comedy, and who composed the music?
You don't want to know about My Fair Lady.
No, not at all. No,
what a pity. I knew the answer. I knew the answer to that.
Earlier Shaw play that became a musical comedy. Who wrote it?
An earlier Shaw play that became a musical comedy.
It's the one. Chocolate Soldier.
Chocolate Soldier, which was Arms and the Man.
Yeah, that's right, yes. And who composed the music?
Was this one of the Viennese lot?
Yes.
This wasn't Robert Stolz.
Stolz?
Yeah.
Now, I really can't give you any more chances, can I? It's Oscar Strauss.
Ah.
Frank, in what opera by which composer does Gingerbread play an important part and why?
Gingerbread?
Trial by Jury. Guilt. Hang on a bit, he's writing again. I just want a few moments to compose my thoughts, Steve, about this. May I suggest it? The memories come... What's that word? The memories coming back. Hansel and Gretel. Humperdinck. Humperdinck? Hansel and Gretel... Humperdinck.
Humperdinck, Humperdinck.
Well, yeah. Does that mean anything to you?
Yes, it means...
It means anything to me at all.
Gingerbread.
You haven't really told us why gingerbread comes
into
the story.
Well, the story of Hansel and Gretel, of course, was because there was a gingerbread, lovely gingerbread cottage in the woods. And Hansel and Gretel, I think, were turned into gingerbread at one point in the plot.
Yeah.
And it's all about a gingerbread cottage and the whole thing of baking children into gingerbread.
That's very good, you know, that's worth 3 marks. I've got a load of old rubbish here, is the answer. It ends with some stuff about the oven bursts under the strain, the ogress is killed, and her death sets free all the other gingerbread children who turn into ordinary children again, and all ends happily.
Well, you think that's
a opinion.
I thought so, yes. A round of operetta and musical comedy questions. For 2 marks, can you identify the source and the composer of the following? David, one for you.
And if you call for the song of the sea, we'll hear the captain loud. With a yo-heave-ho for the wind is returned, to the fifth on the helm for the hurrah for the homeward bound.
Yo-ho-heave-ho, hurrah for the homeward bound.
In a howling breeze, they tickle a fence's pace. But the happiest star of sailor is when he's down on an ill and found with his Nancy on his knees. Yah!
I feel justified in saying, think before you respond. Which source and by whom?
I thought at first it was the Flying Dutchman. Then I disregarded that thought. It's obviously a yard and a half of yo-heave-ho-ery. I would have said that it was by Mrs. Gilbert and Sullivan, but I imagine that it isn't Gilbert and Sullivan.
Well, the music is by Sullivan. That's one of your 2 marks.
Ah, that means that the book was not by Gilbert. This is the thing that they did.
No, I'm sorry. I'm even misleading you a little. I just want you to give name of opera, please.
Oh, well. So, something about the sea, Pinafore or the Pirates, one or t'other.
I did my level best for you. I said, name of opera, please. It's the Mikado. Where it comes from.
I'm sorry, I thought that was the way you normally say it.
One mark for saying Sullivan. Denis Norden, here's one for you.
Ring, 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 ring.
this is drink, drink, drink.
Yes.
And there are other words, but I'm quite unfamiliar. The drink, as it's called, the drinking song.
Yes.
Mainly because of this constant reiteration of the exhortation to drink, drink, drink. The student prince.
Yes. Bye.
Sigmund Romberg.
Romberg, yes, 2 marks for that. Ian, here's one for you. The source, please, as well as the composer, remember.
Ha-ha, the lark at heaven's gate sings, and beavers in the rise. He seeks to water at the spring, until it's love and dies.
Here.
And it's hark, hark, good luck.
Yes.
Well done. Jolly good. Well done.
And it's the tenor singing,
yes. Who composed the music?
I haven't the slightest idea.
Interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I'll have to tell you, won't I?
You will.
It was composed by Schubert. To words, of course, by Shakespeare, and it ended up in Lilac Time.
So my mate knew that.
I
my
saw
mate
that.
Did. My mate knew it.
I saw that at the Devonshire Park Theatre, Eastbourne, when I was 8. So it's rather a long time ago.
Frank, is it? That on for a little time because it's such a nice bit of singing, isn't it?
Don't say goodbye. Yes. Very nostalgic. Probably didn't do very well, hence Nostalgie de la Boue. It's called Don't Say Goodbye.
Very good.
That's yes. Right.
Now, for 2 marks, what did it... what did it come from and who wrote it?
I think it came from an operetta of the 30s.
I should think so. Maybe earlier, I don't know.
Maybe earlier.
Well, I don't know. I just don't know.
It doesn't give any indication, because anybody can say goodbye. I mean, a Canadian Mountie can say goodbye to an Indian maiden, or... A chap in the deserts can say goodbye to a Rif maiden, or up on the White Horse Inn in the snow, somebody can... Oh, no, it's the other. Goodbye, goodbye, I bid you all a last goodbye. That's another one, isn't it?
No, no, anybody, not know at such length.
Rosemary. Yes, terrible. I cannot. We not know for half an hour every week.
Secret number. Secret.
New moon. Rosemary. No, no, Nanette.
Keep going.
Yes, yes, Ruth.
No. I shall come in here and tell you it was Wild Violets, the one you forgot to mention.
Oh, by. They.
No. Yes, it was they. By Stultz. No marks there. You might like to know that whereas David Franklin and Frank Muir have 7 marks, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden have 10 marks. Famous instrumental vocal combinations or groups that have their own styles. Forget the tune, but for 2 marks, identify the orchestra or group, David.
I discard the Harry Orchestra conducted by Barbarolle. So you think that's good scheme?
A stab in the Hammersmith dark.
Well, a stab in the Hammersmith dark, it's Joe Loss.
Well, no, I'm afraid not. It was the London Symphony Orchestra conducted by Edmundo Ross, actually. I think perhaps not terribly typical of Edmundo Ross, but it was the Edmundo Ross Orc. So I'm afraid that's no marks. Yes, it was rather an enlarged orc, I think, for the record.
Oh, that brass suddenly came in.
Yes, all right. Denis, here's one for you to listen to.
Olé.
All right. Well, the modern jazz quartet, it isn't. isn't it Jimmy Shand?
Right.
Isn't that Scottish dancing type music?
Trois, Marx. Very good. Ian, here's yours. I'm not going to ask you for his Christian name, just his surname.
Well, that's 4 million strings conducted by Mantovani.
Yes, right, right. Two
and, it's, and it's interesting, I think.
1 million violins.
It's actually 250,000 violins.
You were saying?
I was only saying that it is fascinating that that effect is not produced electronically, because I once had the great privilege of singing with that orchestra and found they could do that marvellous sort of thing on their own without any sort of echo chambers or anything.
You're not Charmaine, are you?
I've been accused of many things in my time.
No, it is interesting. That is the way the actually, it's the way the violin parts are distributed between the different desks of violinists. And it was invented, I think, originally thought of by one Ronald Binge,
yes,
who wrote it in an arrangement for Mantovani. Frank, I'm listening for you. E femmina che ho fresca e bella, carre da mesa fanno a mille, e faccio concorrenza non faccia.
Italians,
yes.
Quartet,
yes.
Marino Marini.
Two marks, yes. Now we come to the really difficult bit. In this round, you will hear played the first few bars of an old traditional song, played actually on the mellotron by Graham Dalley, for 3 marks. Continue the song with the correct words. David.
Oh, where and oh, where has my Highland laddie gone? Oh, where and oh, where has my Highland laddie gone? Oh, where and oh, where has my Highland laddie gone? Now, all together! Oh, where and oh, where has my Highland laddie gone?
Good, right, sir.
The title of that piece was Where and Aware Has My Highland Laddie Gone?
I think 2 for sheer effrontery out of 3 for that version of The Bluebells of Scotland. I must tell you, on my card here, it says underneath in brackets, music doubtful, but a Mrs. Jordan is mentioned.
Never by me.
Never in the mess, I trust, yes.
It's better than saying Mrs. Jordan doubtful, but music is mentioned.
Right, some singing now, ultimately, from Denis Norden.
I, you know, I haven't sung this, heard it, since I used to sing this in Scouts.
You never told me.
I did. It was the only time in my life when I really was clean in thought, word, and deed. If I die, I die, I die. If I die, if I die. If I die, I die, I die. If I die, I die.
3 marks. That's what I've got here.
Oh, that's all there are.
Do you know the verse?
Yes, it's about, it's Excelsior, yes, actually.
Right. Alpine Village, Strange Device, and all the rest of it. That's 3 marks. That's the way to do it. Ian, here's one for you. In any
in a buddy, meet a buddy, Need a buddy cry? Here, a lassie has a laddie, name this day, hey, hey.
Hold on,
yet all the lads they smile at me when coming through the rye.
Yes. It is, of course, a girl's song.
I thought that was almost too beautiful. 3 marks for that, and Frank, something for you to follow.
Up your rifle. This is a country ballad known as Strawberry Fair.
Oh. By Mrs. Jordan?
Doubtful.
It was and I was going to Strawberry Fair. I haven't the volume of Ian Wallace, but
singing,
singing, daisies. I met a maiden.
This is the best bit.
Rifle.
Must get this bit right. No. Must get this bit right.
Rifle, tiddle-little-ifle. Rifle.
Are you free to do the Messiah on December?
I think that was right, give or take a tolly riddle, I know. That's right. 3 marks for that. And in this round, you shall be played upon the phonograph a few bars of a song, a record, actually. And for 2 marks, I shall expect you to give me the title and the artist or artists who have made these particular numbers popular. I warn you, they are rather on the brief side, so you have to listen very intently. David, here's yours. Well, it's a long one to write down for him, Frank, isn't it?
I didn't recognise the voice. This is an artist who is actually playing his or her own accompaniment.
Oh, I wouldn't say that for a minute. Not even Daddy was playing the accompaniment here, no.
This is Daddy. What beautiful writing you have, haven't you?
Probably legible.
Nancy Sinatra.
Yes. And the title of the song. Has he got that written down for you as well? Frank.
I don't know.
Can you give the title of the song?
Those boots were made for walking, David.
Oh!
And that's just what they'll do. These boots were made for walking, and they'll walk right over you.
We have to have all the rest.
Well, it's an approximation to the words of the song. I think your words are actually better than the words in the song, Frank. 2 points for that. Dennis, the record for you to listen to. Please listen very closely.
That's the song which caused the boundaries of popular music to be renegotiated.
Yes.
It's Eleanor Rigby by Lennon and McCartney. And I believe that's McCartney's own arrangement.
I think that's going into bit. I don't think he can write for a string quartet.
Well, he hums it, and George Martin comes in and says, all right, lad, I'll put the dots down.
Yes. 2 marks. Ian, a vocal one for you.
What am I to do?
It's all there.
Try Maria Callas.
I'm going to try Sandy Shaw.
That was a good guess, really, from an opera singer. It wasn't Sandy Shaw. In fact, let's give you... Yes, it was... Yes, that came from the wrong side. It was, in fact, Cilla Black. Do you know the name of the song? I shouldn't think.
Anyone who had a...
Yes!
A what?
A heart!
Yes, so you retrieve 1 mark from the debris of that.
My friend did.
Now, all attention, please, from Frank for your record.
Where there is a pavement or any great foot on, use it.
Frank Muir.
The Highway Code.
Yes, sung by.
I think it's the Master Singers.
Yes, absolutely right. Yes, the Master Singers by Wagner. The Master Singers, 2 marks. Yes. And I'm afraid that brings us to the end of this edition of My Music, in which Ian Wallace and Denis Norden won by 3 marks.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Denis Norden, Frank Muir, and Ian Wallace. The chairman was Steve Race. At the mellotron was Graham Dalley. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason. The program, which was recorded, was produced by Tony Schreier. We present My Music, a new musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here to introduce the two teams is your chairman, Steve Race.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of My Music, in which the team's knowledge of music of all kinds will be tested in a series of questions, and we hope you at home will try to answer them too. Our two teams here consist of, as usual, David Franklin and Frank Muir versus Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. And we start with round one. Well-known orchestral masterpieces. 1 mark for the composer, another mark for the title. 2 marks in all. David Franklin, here's yours. For the title, the other for the composer.
You said well-known orchestral. To whom?
This wasn't written in your stars, this one, was it?
No.
Well, I said written in your stars. It is from The Planets, suite by Gustav Holst, the movement Uranus. No marks, I'm afraid, out of two. And Denis Norden, here's your bit of tape. We do sometimes make them a little easier for Denis, I must say. Denis, whose wedding was that?
Whose
wedding is that?
Little-known piece, which only the really informed music lovers know. It's the Flight of the Bumblebee by that well-known team, Fred Rimsky and George Korsakoff.
I'm bound to give you 2 marks. I tried to put you off by asking whose wedding it was. I thought you were going to say the Bee's wedding. Yeah. You're quite right. And we move on to Ian Wallace and some music for you, Ian.
I would say that was... incidentally, before I tell you, despite what you said about Denis, you make them easy, he knew that was the Planet Suite. I just want to defend my partner.
Yes, I think that's absolutely marvellous.
And I will now proceed to answer my question, which I take it to be the Sorcerer's Apprentice, Duca.
Very good. Unfortunately, incorrect. It's... Oh. You're quite right. The Sorcerer's Apprentice was by Dukar, but this was Scheherazade by Rimsky-Korsakov. I'm sorry.
Can I leap into the ring and announce to a breathless world that my partner, Frank Muir, Esquire, knew what that was.
Yes. The difference being that he couldn't spell his one, but I could.
Let's now have the piece of music that everybody but Frank Muir knows.
We think it's Rossini.
You're right.
Well, fine.
And who's it by?
Rossini. We think it's the Barber of Seville.
Only a snip, of course, from it. Yes, the Barber of Seville, the overture, the Barber of Seville by Rossini. Two marks for that, and we move on. In the next round, for two marks, some general questions, all concerned, of course, with music or musical terms. David, we're back with you again. In which work, by which composer, would you find the character Center? S-E-N-T-A.
Center. In Der Fliegende Holländer, by Dick Wagner.
Yes.
She's the heroine, she falls for the Flying Dutchman.
Yes.
And at the end of the opera, she joins him because he's going to be saved. Do you want all this? He's going to be saved from eternal damnation by the love of a good woman. And they disappear beneath the waves, never to be seen again. The end.
Two marks for that. Denis Norden, what is a nonet?
Nonet sounds like what we used to call in the service is the unexpired portion of your day's ration. But I would say, etymologically, it sounds like a nine-sided orchestra. Uh-huh. Or an orchestra with, either an orchestra with nine players in, or one musician who looks rather nine-sided.
I don't think it's anything to do with Hey Nonet. No.
No, you're quite right. It's two string quartets and their manager. Ian Wallace, a very difficult one for you, I think. What is the meaning of svelto? I'll spell it if you like. Svelto.
Svelto.
S-V-E-L-T-O.
Quickly.
Yes, I have to take that. Yes, you're right. Two marks. It means, according to my information here, smart, quick, light, nimble. It is Italian for smart, quick, light, nimble. Two marks. Frank, what musically were marrow bones and cleavers?
Well, medieval goop.
Yes. Yes, actually.
Cleaver is a sort of narrow axe used only by butchers. Marrow bones are the other end of the axe, normally. Apart from that, I have no idea.
You don't have to have any idea beyond that, actually.
Are they musical instruments?
Yes, you get your two marks. The answer I have written down here. The answer is so highly improbable, I think I'll just read it as it stands. The traditional music of the butchers of England and Scotland. Occasionally they may still be played at weddings of the fraternity.
Hum one.
As a poet said in 1763, quote, hark how the banging marrow bones make clanging cleavers ring, unquote, two marks. And on.
Yes, very quickly. I did ask you to sing an example.
A round of tunes from stage and film musicals. For three marks this time, I want the title of the song, the name of the musical from which it's taken, and the composer concerned. David Franklin.
Gayer than laughter are you, sweeter than music are you, angel and lover.
You don't have to give me the nose of the singer it was sung through. Just the name of the piece and the show and the composer, please.
Younger than springtime are you.
Well, don't spoil it. Younger than springtime, yes.
It comes from South Pacific,
Yes.
And the music is by whichever of Rodgers and Hammerstein did the music.
Rodgers.
The other one did the lyrics.
Yes, you get your 3 marks. Very good. And one for Denis Norden.
There was half a bar of timpani in Hospital, thundering, thundering all along the way. Double bell euphoniums and big bassoons, each bassoon having his big fat say. There were 50 mounted cannons in the battery, thundering, thundering.
Dennis, how many? I mean, what? Sorry. What was that called?
That was Robert Preston singing 76 trombones from The Music Man by Meredith Wilson.
Gratuitous information. Only 3 marks. You named the singer as well. 3 marks. Jolly good. Ian Wallace, can you tell us what this is called, first of all, and then who?
I love Paris in the springtime. I love Paris in the fall. I love Paris in the winter when it drizzles. I love Paris in the summer.
Now, can you figure out what that was called, Ian?
It was called
I Love Paris.
Yes, I'm not going to give you any marks for that.
Oh, yes.
Because of the number of times that appeared in the song, we're going to give you 1 mark for who wrote the music, 1 for the show it came from, and 1 mark for who wrote the words.
Oh, well, I would say that the show was called Can Can.
1 mark, yes.
Or Con Con.
Yes, Con Con. It's nicer, isn't it? Let's have the composer in French, too.
Composer in French?
Well, if you wish, you know, I'm
there
not...
There is a French word.
It's a French word.
It's a French word.
Colporteur.
Colporteur.
And who wrote the Mo?
The Mo?
Yes.
Yes, I'm not so clear on who wrote the Mo.
I don't know.
No, I'm afraid I'll have to stick on 2 marks.
Ah, yes, you only get 2 there. Cool Porter wrote the words as well.
Oh!
And now one for Frank Muir. Who is doing what where?
June is apparently busting out all over.
Yes.
And it comes from Carousel, a musical comedy by... Yes, it is. Yes, it is, madam. Yes. Lady in the Front Row, The Carousel by Messrs. Rodgers and Mrs. Hammerstein. Mr. Rodgers wrote the music and Mr. Hammerstein wrote the lyric.
Quite right, and you get your 3 marks. All that. General musical knowledge questions. 4, 2 marks, once again. David Franklin, who wrote Cavalleria Rusticana and how many acts does it have?
And why? One side of the paper only.
The why part of it is fairly easy. He wrote it for money.
Yeah.
It was written by Mascagni.
Yes.
And it has one act, but it's divided into 2 scenes by the intermezzo.
How well you put things. Better, in fact, than the chap who writes the answers down for me, because he just put down one act. You're right. Yes, very good. Very good. Yes, 2 marks, and usually performed with, very often with Pagliacci, known to musicians as Cav and Peg.
That's it.
Quite right, yes. Denis Norden, with what instrument in particular do you associate the name of Carl Dolmetsch?
Well, Dolmetsch I associate not with an instrument, but with extras on school bills. To recorder lessons. You have to get a Dolmetsch record, yeah.
The recorder, yes, 2 marks. Ian Wallace, who was responsible for the words and music of the original version of The Beggar's Opera, please?
John Gay.
Yes, wrote
the music.
In that case, who wrote the
words?
the words.
Oh, yes, oh, no, the music was a splendid gentleman called Pepusch.
Yes, that's right. Do you know what his medical qualifications were? Yes. Very good. John Gay wrote the libretto. Dr. Pepusch arranged and compiled the music taken from traditional airs. Frank, who or what do you understand by palestrina?
Palestrina is It's like lasagna. It's got a layer of antipasto, and then it's got tomato. Antipasto, and then it's got minced veal and garlic. And the whole thing is in a sort of light oil and olive sauce.
And it's polyphonic.
Oh, frequently, yeah.
Well, that's 2 stars in the Good Food Guide. There's no marks in this game.
Yes, on the other hand...
Mike Parker was just fooling you the whole time.
Yes. Yes. On the other hand, he could well have been a composer.
Well, yes.
The Palestinian era, though, you know, swept a certain part of a certain country for a certain number of years, a certain epoch.
He was in the charts week after week in the 16th century.
16th century, I'll be good, yes. Kirchhoff, 1525 to 1594. Incidentally, Palestrina is a place on the edge of the Campagna Romana where this particular chap, I'll attempt to say his name, Giovanni Pierluigi da Palestrina, was born. He's like El Greco. He came from the place and was named after it. I get 2 marks there, I don't think... Oh, no, I don't.
But El Greco didn't come from that place.
No, but he was called Greece. The Greek, yes. Wasn't he? Yes, so that's to save all the nasty letters we get. Yeah. Sure. Might interest you to know that David Franklin and Frank Muir are leading at the moment by 1 mark. Now, in the next round, gentlemen, you'll find you have to concentrate not on the title of the tune, but on the particular sound of the performers. For 2 marks, can you identify the following musical combinations? David, for you. I don't want the opera it comes from, just the the name of the performers, please.
Well, you said at first on the sound, on the instruments. I was going to say guitars and ask for my 2 marks.
Some hopes. No, the no. Name, please.
I only know one group.
Well, you'll be right if you guess them.
The Shadows?
Yes. The Shadows for 2 marks. Playing, incidentally, a piece called FBI. Denis Norden, here's yours. Fairly difficult, I think. Quite a puzzle.
Yeah.
Quite a puzzle.
I don't know. It could be any of the American... Well, it could be in English. Big bands of the LP type. What? David Rose? No.
A very nice answer. I did say quite a puzzle in an attempt to help you. For 1 mark, you get it now.
Oh, wait a minute.
Yes. Napoleon puzzle, you know.
Yeah, Nelson Riddle.
Nelson Riddle, yes. I can only give you 1, though, for that, can't I?
Yeah. 1 mark. Crossword puzzle game.
Ian, this one you may know from the tune. Well, now, incidentally, one of the few orchestras which type to have a tuba, but do you know the answer?
Johnny Dankworth.
Yes, Johnny Dankworth. The tune, do you know the name of the tune, incidentally?
No, I'm afraid I don't.
It's African Waltz. Yes, yes. 2 marks, anyway. And Frank Muir, here's yours.
Compiler for one of the most idiosyncratic noises, Herb Albert
and
the Tijuana Brass.
Yes, thank you. 2 marks. Change of musical subject now. When When jazz became newsworthy, the journalists plugged away at certain slang words, though personally I never heard any jazz musicians using them. Nevertheless, you probably know them. For 2 marks, what would you say the following meant? David Franklin, a canary. In jazz, a canary.
Jazz? Heaven knows, in my side of the business, a canary means a coloratura soprano.
That's good enough, a girl singer.
A girl singer?
Yes.
Really?
Yes, well, two marks, yes. Denis Norden, the adjective here, or the first word of the two, why was it called a tailgate trombone in jazz? Tailgate trombone.
I believe because when at one period of jazz, when they played on the backs of what we would call lorries and what they would call trucks, the trombonist would presumably sit right on the tailgate, on the end of it.
That's lovely. With his slide working over the tail.
Would not
appear
with the man
yes.
in front.
That is a phrase
well
that
done.
Musicians did use. Ian Wallace, what would you say was a lick? A lick.
A lick?
Hmm.
Well, it's not when they sort of put their tongue into the mouthpiece of the trumpet and go...
No, that's called a...
Well, I mean, you use the same thing for a as you do for a lick, don't you?
No, but I didn't ask you about a. I asked you about it's a hot lick, say. What about
obligato. It's
a
solo bit, isn't it? It's a well, another dated word is a riff.
It's not quite the same thing as a riff.
A cadenza.
Taking off on a solo flight.
No, I'm going to give you one. And be jolly generous about this. The essence of the answer is that you must have said it's a short phrase.
Uh-huh.
A hot lick or a lick was a very short phrase. 100 licks for trumpet by Louis Armstrong, something like that, you know. That was really what it meant. So you're lucky to get the one there. And Frank Muir, what is, was, or will be, or for that matter, where, if you prefer, is a licorice stick.
It was a clarinet, wasn't it?
Yes. 2 marks. Very good. Let's have a look at the score, shall we? Oh, yes, the position's been reversed. Ian Wallace and Denis Norden now leading by 1 mark. And now for what I hope will prove to be a vocal round, and that goes for you too, Denis. You usually try and get out of singing at this point. You will hear Graham Dalley playing on the mellotron 4 traditional songs, one to each of you, for 3 marks. I want you to sing and sing the words. First of all, David Franklin. Now, would you like to sing that for us, David?
Oh, it's way too late in the starry night in the season of the year. Oh,
that's Frank.
I am, in fact, a ventriloquist. Go on.
No.
Well,
oh, you know it.
Oh, it's... in your voice. My delight in the starry night in the season of the year.
To do what?
What do you mean, do what?
What is it my delight on a starry night to do?
You know yourself better than I do.
You actually want me to sing about that?
I'm Italian, of course.
This is one of the things that I vaguely heard and never really mastered. No marks.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, you don't even know what it's called. Not that you get any marks for that. It's Lincolnshire Poacher, and it's been sung very adequately by your teammate. We'll give him 1 mark out of 3. I think you don't know it, do you, David, this one?
No.
Lincolnshire Poacher. My home county, you've never heard of it. Denis, here's yours.
To my girl.
Give me the ones that have 2 versions.
Also very high.
Not the one at the Battle of Waterloo, where you had trouble with a breeze. Some talk of Alexander and some of Hercules. Of Lysander, but of all the world's great heroes, there's none that can compare with a rototo yes. and similar.
And you gave them a key change.
Yes.
What's more,
well, you do get key changes. I have this built-in harmonic thing, you know.
It's the British Grenadiers. Yes. And it's filled with a boom, boom, in the middle of a cup final.
He talks a lot and sings very little, doesn't he? Yes. Three marks. It wasn't three marks. It wasn't ro-to-to-to. It was to-ro-ro-ro, according to the copy I had. Yeah. You know, a mere tip of the slung, that was. Ian, here's yours.
Presumably want me to look over Jordan now.
I think you might at least have sung it for us, but never mind. Three. No, that was lovely, Ian. Thank you very much. Three. That raised the whole tone of the show. 3 marks for that. Frank, follow that.
That's what the old folks say.
That's what the old folks say. All the world and sad and weary, everywhere I roam, longing for the old plantation. From the old folks at home.
As you say, Old Man River. 3 marks. Very good. And I'm afraid that brings us to the end of this edition of My Music, in which Ian Wallace and Denis Norden won by 3 marks.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Denis Norden, Frank Muir, and Ian Wallace. The chairman was Steve Race. At the mellotron was Graham Dalley. Questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason. The program, which was recorded, was produced by Tony Schreier. We present My Music, a new musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here to introduce the two teams is your chairman, Steve Race.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of My Music. Our two teams comprise, on the one hand, David Franklin and Frank Muir, and on the other hand, Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. So, without further preamble, or even ado, let's go straight into round one. Listen, please, with ears akimbo to this round, because you won't have much time to identify the musical composition concerned. You'll just hear a chord or two, or a bar or two, from the opening of a well-known classic. And I want you for 2 marks to identify the piece and its composer. First of all, David Franklin.
It's piano concerto.
Yes.
It's piano with an orchestra.
Yes.
They're playing a piece called a piano concerto. Written
yes.
By a composer who wrote pieces like piano concerti by the name of Grieg.
What key would you like?
Well, what have you got?
I've got A minor.
I was going to say A minor.
Yeah, fair enough.
You want me to transpose it?
Very good, and such a lovely crisp answer, too. Two marks. Denis Norden, listen to this.
It's the fame Beethoven Moonlight Sonata.
Yes, two marks. Ian, here's the bit of music for you to listen to. I should warn you, that isn't Grieg's piano concerto.
No, I didn't think it was.
No. You were right not to.
Well done, Ian.
Thank you. Yes. Nothing like a musical education. Particularly as I never had one. Studied law. But something tells me that that's a violin concerto.
Yes.
And something also tells me that it could have been written by a fellow called Tchaikovsky.
It could, but wasn't.
Oh.
I'm afraid no.
It's a violin concerto.
Sorry, you get one mark for that. It's the beginning of Mendelssohn's, I'm afraid.
So it is.
Yes, so it is. In E minor. Right, Frank Muir, listen very closely.
It's a national anthem.
Do you know? You can have it again if you'd like it again.
Yes.
Could have it again, please, that one.
It's the wedding march.
Yes.
By?
Yes. Well, it's when they come out of the vestry.
Oh, by the vestry door, yes.
Yes.
Composed by?
Mendelssohn.
Yes. The only tune I know, incidentally, you can recognise just from the first chord only. It's from Mendelssohn's Incidental Music to A Midsummer Night's Dream. You get two marks there. In the next round, I'm going to ask you to use your imaginations. It's this way. Many of today's composers write what we call mood music for use in atmospheric films or radio or TV plays. The titles are a good indication of what the composers think they might be used for. Robert Farnham, to take an example, wrote a piece called Broad Canvas, which is ideal, musically speaking, for the windjammer kind of film. I'm sure you get the idea. I have four examples here, one for each of you, and I want you to see what sort of a vision they conjure up. In fact, can you get near to the composer's own title? David Franklin, what title would you give this?
This mortuary. The door opens and in walks a monster, his hands reeking with blood. He goes up to one of the corpses, finds a knife in his pocket and plunges it into the heart of the corpse. My title for this piece is Fun in the Dissection Room.
That's very good. Would you care to hazard a guess at what month it took place in? What month it took place in?
It was a foggy night in November.
That's incredible, because in fact, it's really uncanny. The piece is called November Fog. He was not privy to this, I assure you. November Fog, it was called. Incredible, that marvellous. Two marks, David. Denis, the title for this, please.
I tell you what it puts in mind. It puts in mind one of those rather dull short films you see before the big film. And the man is saying, nesting in a fold of the Cotswold villages, as our camera traverses this beautiful scene. We see that time has touched it but lightly. Nevertheless, they are working for export and are making ferrules for shooting sticks in these little thatched cottages. It's a kind of travelling, I would call it Cotswold Stroll.
Yes, you get your 2 marks. The piece, just for the record, was called Sewing Circle.
I can only say there's 2 marks. Pure charity. Yes.
I really think your saying, sir. Your title was better than the composer's, I think. Ian Wallace, here's one for you to give a title to.
Well, various things come into one's mind. One fears that the composer was influenced to some extent by Sullivan and the Mikado, because I can hear behind that. That. So there's a sort of Japanese flavour to it. And it's a Japanese computer. It's probably a computer to do with insurance, because they do all your insurance things nowadays through a computer. That's why they all arrive with inaccuracies on them. And they say this is because the computer is no better than the two 17-year-old girls who feed it the information. So my title for that would be No Claim Bonus in Tokyo.
I think I must knock one off for the Oriental emphasis. It's more Occidental than that. So I'll give you 1 mark for that. It's actually called January Sales. Frank Muir, here's one for you.
Definitely here under the influence of drink. It started off in a fairly sort of macabre sort of way. An air of mystery. And there's also an elephantine feeling about it. One would suppose it's hijinks in the elephant house.
Oh, yes. Yes, you mentioned drink and things, didn't you? I think your title's better than the composer's. I'll give you 2 for that. The composer's title is Closing Time. A round of questions on general musical topics. For 2 marks, David Franklin, in what opera was Home Sweet Home first sung and who wrote it?
Is it one of these early 19th century English operas that's now neglected?
Yes, I would say
and
so.
Rightfully neglected.
Yes, I would say so.
Something like, wait a minute, it's not Maritana.
No.
It's not The Bohemian Girl, but there's another one about that period.
It's even less known, actually.
What?
Even less known than those, yes.
Yes. Is it The Lily of Killarney?
No, that's a fair old guess. No, I have to give you a man, I'm afraid, for this. If you like, I'll tell you the name of the opera and then a mark if you can get the composer. The opera Clary, The Maid of Milan. English words and libretto by the American John Howard Payne. Music by... Any idea?
Anon.
No, he wasn't. He was Sir Henry Bishop. And I think he was 19th century, although it doesn't say so here. I think he was. Sorry about that. Denis, what is the difference between the chorus in an Elizabethan or Shakespearean play and the chorus in a modern musical?
Well, sex, in a nutshell, but sort of functionally, the chorus, originally the chorus in a Greek play or in an Elizabethan play, in some of Shakespeare's plays, provides a sort of commentary on the action and narrates some of the kind of bridge passages of the action as well. And then the chorus became sort of, First of all, they restocked our aristocracy later. then they became the tired businessmen thing. But now that we don't, our businessmen aren't so tired because there isn't the business around. They're now girls who sing and dance and go and study method acting in their spare time and are appallingly virtuous.
Oh, I wouldn't know about that. Did you get 2 marks for the answer anyway? Ian, which opera by which composer marked the first great landmark in the history of opera?
You wouldn't mean Gluck. That was a great landmark. You mean earlier than Gluck, do you?
I'll give you a mark for thinking of such an early composer. Yes. I don't mean Gluck, in fact, no.
You mean something nearer 1600?
Yes, 1607 to be exact.
The opera, I think, was Orfeo.
Yes.
And Gluck also wrote Orfeo, but this was somebody with a name like Rubini or some such name like that of the Italians.
Well, this was the Verdi who came from the mountains.
Oh, Monteverdi.
Monteverdi, yes. Orfeus, I've got here, Orfeus Monteverdi, performed in Mantua in 1607. So very erudite of you to know. I think I just must give him 2 marks, gentlemen.
Oh, very good.
Yeah, 2 marks. Very good. Frank Muir, what is a bombardment?
A very noisy affair, indeed. It's isn't it a double bass euphonium?
Very good. Do you wish to say any more?
Not if it's very good.
No, it's very good. Brass people talk about the double B flat bombardment. You're quite right. Yeah. 2 marks. Well, now we have a round entirely devoted to opera. For 3 marks, I want the name of the aria, the title of the opera, and the name of the composer. David.
I know that a such misfortune, there is no consolation but the choice future.
That wasn't David Franklin singing, but it's now David Franklin telling us what it was.
Well, David Franklin points out that it was apparently not an aria, but a duet. Either that or it was a very remarkable anatomical change in the singer. Let's not go into that. Do you know, I haven't a clue what it is.
Puccini? No?
But what opera is it?
Butterfly.
And bless myself.
Pinkerton's Farewell. Saying farewell, presumably, to a tenor. Just by the end of it. Well, no marks there, I'm afraid.
I didn't know that.
Denis, here's an operatic aria for you. All day, but we have to stop there and ask Denis what it was.
I think it would be necessary for me to listen to it all. I must point out to listeners that not only is Ian Wallace a very fine singer, he has magnificent handwriting as well. I will read. Boheme, Puccini, an Italian phrase crossed out. And underneath it, they call me Mimi.
Did you read out Puccini with an R? P-R, Puccini, does that mean?
No, you cannot. You can't even fault him on spelling. No.
I was faulting you on reading, actually.
And you see, the Italian phrase that I'd crossed out was one fine day. I was going to read it as one fine day.
Ian's also very honest, isn't he? They call me Mimi from La Bohème by Puccini. 3 marks for that. Ian, here's your turn, and let's see if Dennis can write this one down for you.
I'm going to go and have a smoke during this.
Dennis has drawn it.
This is not one of the operas I've ever perpetrated anything in, but it is the Anvil Chorus. Mm. That much I know. And
where did it come from?
Well, I would say it came from Faust, but I think I would be wrong, in which case it comes from Trovatore.
That's a very good way of getting marks out of me, isn't it?
And if it's by Trovatore, it's undoubtedly by Verdi.
Or worse to that effect, yes. The Anvil Chorus is just very, you so rightly said, from Il Trovatore. Frank Muir, here's one for you to identify.
Well, we've had a little chat here while that nice music was on. We are of the impression that it's a soldier's chorus from Faust by Gourno.
Il
Gourno.
Il Gourno, the Italian.
Bonjour. Not his condition of health. Just his Gourno. No,
well, I'll give you the 3 all the same, yes. Gourno, you're quite right when you said Gourno.
Your thing has got a cheaper pen than mine.
Now, Frank said Gourno with such tremendous conviction. Let the name be changed in all the books from now on.
In this round, you're going to hear some tunes you'll probably recognise at once. But what I want is not the title of the popular version. It's the title of the serious piece from which it's taken. David Franklin, listen to this.
I've got this wrong. That's the popular song, is it?
No, we're listening to the classical piece.
And what was all this business about pop stuff?
It is a pop. Where have you been? I'm always chasing rainbows. It has a brief period of glory.
Frank whispered into my ear just now, it's Mendelssohn, it always is.
Or Tchaikovsky.
No, Mark.
I don't think it's either.
Oh,
that was my delayed action bomb, that was. I think it's Chopin.
Crafty, yes. Chopin's what in what?
Ah, well, now we've got to start on that. Frank thinks it's a nocturne.
Nocturne and the old cat, really. It's the only one I know.
And do you agree with him?
Well, half of me, there seem to be 2 possibilities. Could be a nocturne, it could be an etude.
Am I allowed to step in now and tell you you've got no marks at all?
But I got Chopin.
Well, yes, you get one. It's Chopin's Fantasy Impromptu in C-sharp minor, opus 666.
I was going to get round to the Fantasy Impromptus later on.
No, you weren't. Only one, anyway, I think. Right, 1 mark of that, and jolly lucky too. Dennis, listen to this.
This is very strange, actually, because just before the program, I was talking to Ian, who's going over to America to talk about a musical which was written by going to be written by the same people who wrote Kismet. Mm. And this one they're going to do was Saint-Saëns. Mm. And he said, the same people who wrote Kismet. And I said, who was that based on? He said, Borodin. So as of about, 20 minutes ago, I happen to know, but that was borrowed from Borodin.
Yes, borrowed in 1950, to be precise, for the show Kismet. But what was the title of the original piece, please?
Well, we didn't... Then they said...
Hey, you're on.
Yes, wait a minute. The writing on the... Prince Igor.
Yes, the Pavlovsian dances from Prince Igor. Good enough. 2 marks. Ian, I don't know if you're appearing in the version of this, but here's the music for you to listen to.
Somebody did a whole... It was Beethoven. I don't know this myself, but I heard it on the radio program.
I think it was Beethoven. Because I'm at what's laughingly described at a loss here.
Don't know. I think...
No, I don't
know. No, I don't blame you. It's the theme from the second movement of the Sonata Pathétique by Beethoven, so you get your 1 mark for Beethoven. Ken Dodd's song was called More Than Love. Frank, here's one for you.
Hello, mother. Hello, father.
Try the Dance of the Hours.
Dance of the Hours. Mr. Reyes, yes, Dance of the Hours...
Are you submitting that as being the answer, or just trying it on to see how I look at you?
Both.
2 marks, yes, Dance of the Hours. You know, of course, who it's by.
Yes, hang on.
Pontielli.
Isn't this his chap?
Yes, it is.
Pontielli.
Pontielli with a curse. The
Pontielli.
Pontielli from La Gioconda. You get your 2 marks. And we move on. We want you to listen now to some old traditional airs played by Graham Dalley on the mellotron. For 3 marks, I want the teams, each of them, to make an attempt at singing the words of the songs they'll hear. David Franklin, here's yours. Very, very jolly indeed. David.
Whoever picks these folk songs in this series... with diabolical ingenuity, picks tunes that I've never heard of. What is that?
It's the Lass of Richmond Hill. On Richmond Hill there lives a lass more bright than May Day morn, whose charms all other maids surpass, a rose without a thorn. No marks.
Well, I never met her. Well,
Richmond's Yorkshire, not Richmond, Surrey.
Oh, well, that accounts for it.
Ah, yes. And, well, no marks, I'm afraid. Denis, we ask you to sing this, please, having heard it played.
But there ain't a lady living in the land as I'd swap for my dear old dad.
Yes.
No, no.
Oh. You don't need more of this.
Most affecting. 3 marks, yes. Ian, here's yours.
Come, lasses and lads, take leave if you dance. That's all the words I know. Da dum da 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 dum da 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 di da da di da da.
3 marks. Well, 2 to be precise. For every fair... What? Every fair has
somebody's
a sweetheart
standing
there.
By.
The fiddler's standing by. For Willie shall dance with Jane, and Johnny has got his Jones to trip it, trip it, trip it, trip it, trip it up and down. I think they got money for these lyrics. Anyway, you get 2 out of 3 for them. Frank, here's the one for you.
Jan Stewart, Peter Gurney, Peter Davey, Donald Whitten, Ali York, old Uncle Tom Cobley, and
Chum Chum.
Tom Pierce, lend me thy grey mare. Mm. Eld along, Lee. For yes. I would so go to a Willicombe fair with the aforementioned company.
3 marks. That's not Widdicombe, Yorkshire, of course, is it?
That's Widdicombe. Nor Widdicombe, Surrey.
3 marks. And that, I'm afraid, brings us to the end of this edition of My Music, in which Ian Wallace and Denis Norden have won by 3 marks.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Denis Norden, Frank Muir, and Ian Wallace. The chairman was Steve Race. At the mellotron was Graham Dalley. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program, which was recorded, was produced by Tony Shryan.